American citizens reacted very differently to COVID, not physically, not from a medical perspective, but in terms of what they, how they reacted to it and what they thought the government response should be, based on whether politically they were on the left or on the right.
Anyone remember Bluestone and Harrison, Deindustrialization of America? I'm like, that's the inflection point for me. Deindustrialization started, a whole bunch of people started losing steady jobs, and then they're just kind of like sitting in the economy and sitting within the nation, and we just kind of let that fester. And that's white, black, Latino, Asian, everybody. But how that got characterized within each community is interesting, and that has manifestations for the lack of interconnectedness that we're seeing now, because not everyone's seeing that as being an inflection point for why we're in the situation where, that we're in, and then exacerbated by COVID.
I think that the kind of rise of white working class identity is one of the more discouraging trends of the last 5 years. I think a lot of people attribute it to Trump, and I don't think that that's quite right. I think that it's closer to the truth to say that he has really benefited from it. But the idea that there are really a lot of people out there who are beginning to see themselves potentially as a class or as a unified group with special interests that ought to be taken seriously.
Since Christian didn't mention it, I just want to call your attention to two of his research works that really help us understand what so many people are now acknowledging on social media and elsewhere about the double standard between how we represent certain events as nonviolent or violent, depending on the race of the people protesting and the race of the people policing them. And one of them is by Christian, Sarah Sewell, and I think David Armstrong, about, it's called Protesting While Black. It's a really important piece that talks about the effects of the race of the protesters on the way the public sort of defines and understands the events and the level of repression against the protesters.
One thing I think we should highlight real quickly is just that I don't think these protests that we're seeing around the quarantine are all that novel. I mean, I think they're quite similar to what we saw in the Tea Party. You know, there's nationalist rhetoric, anti-government rhetoric, pro-gun rhetoric, white nationalism, conspiracy theories. It's not all that new. What's new is the anti-quarantine piece, but that's just kind of like, you know, in a similar, when you've seen a protest and you have a million different signs, anti-quarantine is one of those signs. So in some ways, I don't see it all as that new. What I see is kind of, and it's not necessarily novel either, but it's troubling, is the fact that they're threatening violence. And you don't bring a gun to a protest and occupy a state building and then think that's nonviolent protest. That's, you know, by most definitions, that's terrorism. You're using violence to, you know, sort of push your political cause. And whether you're just threatening it or using it, it's still kind of what most scholars would call terrorism.
There's all sorts of groups, subgroups in the United States that are suffering. They're suffering in similar ways, some of them different ways, others. And yet they're not mobilizing equally. And what we've really seen, probably starting in 2010 and then accelerating since 2016, is the mobilization of the right. So moving forward, do you anticipate this being met by more mobilization on the left from other groups? Why is the right mobilizing more?
My thing is, Obama helped devastate a lot of that mobilization, because a lot of the mobilization that was going up into that administration were just like, we won, we're good, let's go relax, we don't need to do anything. Black people can protest about policing. Any other topic, I think that there's going to be some difficulties there, because that's one of the things that we protested about a great deal. And thus the institutions are there, the rhetoric is there, the mobilization there, the clarity is there, the connection between protest and those activities. Other topics, a lot harder.
I think Jeremy Pressman and I, in our crowd counting initiative, were able to, I think, reasonably argue that something like 7 or 8 of the largest single day demonstrations in US history have happened since 2016. So the left is not demobilized. It is incredibly fragmented and out of institutional power. And so that's, you know, why it doesn't look like they're mobilized, but they're actually, there's tons of mobilization happening.
We know that one of the structural factors that, you know, struggling economies tend to breed more right-wing violence. And, you know, as we see the kind of, as Jesse was talking about and Erica, that we'll see potentially this dynamic where the right sort of becomes progressively more violent and then factions on the left respond and sort of counter outbid. It's not exactly outbidding, but sort of use violence in response. And those escalation dynamics worry me. I don't think, probably no one on this panel thinks that we're headed for a civil war. No country as strong as ours is likely to ever have a civil war. But I think what you can see is kind of more extreme violence a la, you know, Oklahoma City or events that are just much more brutal than we would have seen in kind of normal times.
To deviate from being a political scientist for a minute and our focus on government and institutions, but I'm like, capitalism is the problem, it's been the problem, and will continue to be the problem. And so, right, these little militias, okay, let's say they get exactly what they want. Okay, things open back up. We're still gonna have the ridiculous amount of inequality we have in the country that is completely underestimated, and folks suffering from things faster or slower.